Just to set the scene, Will is a writer, of course, a novelist, short story writer, over 12 books to his credit, including his most recent novel, The Extraordinary Umbrella, which was shortlisted for the Man Booker Prize. He's also a prolific journalist, TV commentator, I also like to think of Will as a kind of professional Londoner, with his concerns about urbanism and the built environment. And also what's less known about Will, but I'm happy to exclusively reveal, that his uncle was one of the original Madison Avenue madmen, and who had the unique accolade of being responsible for the Pillsbury Doughboy, which gives Will a kind of true historic connection to our world of branding and marketing. So ladies and gentlemen, big welcome to Will Self, and it's great to have you here. Thank you. He's even, his commitment to the streets of London is actually manifest with this handsome Brompton, which he's cycled through the streets on this morning to be here. I'd like to start, Will, there was a radio interview I heard you giving quite a few years ago, and I can't even remember the context of that interview now, but what really stuck in my mind was you suddenly coming out with the words, "Everything is interesting." And you went on to kind of discuss with the interviewer whether or not this was a blessing or a curse. Mm. And I think it resonated very strongly with me, and I think with a lot of people in this room in terms of their day jobs. I'd love you to expand a bit more on "Everything is interesting."
Well, I suppose that a lot of us, a lot of what we're presented with culturally are methods supposedly for holding our interest. And I think it's very easy for us all to fall, I don't think victim is too light a word, to fall victim to seeing ourselves as essentially passive entities who need to be stimulated and excited. And in other words, interest is not a given or an attribute of us, but is something latent within us that can be provoked. And I should imagine a lot of paradigms that people work with in this room do have that kind of underlying dynamic. And I suppose that the "everything is interesting" perspective places the individual subject in control of the capacity for engagement. And I notice it because when I'm working particularly on fiction and on novels, I'm preoccupied by the relationship, the constant synecdochal interplay between part and whole. How does the part of something relate to the whole? How does the whole exemplify the part? And that kind of level of concentration and the attempt to render everything from individual subjective experience to collective perceptions to ideological concerns to how people, what people's systems of decision making are in situ and in action. The relevance in particular of time and the zeitgeist to perception. You know, what are people's minds really full of at any given minute? You know, there is a tendency always in, I think, in the novel and in film and in fictional narratives to schematize the way in which individuals are presented. So enormous attention being focused on this leads you to find everything interesting. And I mean everything interesting.
And when everything is interesting, I mean, how do you draw the boundaries around that?
I find it absolutely impossible, and particularly at the moment. I mean, we were talking about this earlier. I'm just finishing a book at the moment, and I tend to work on novels the way that people allegedly work on repainting the Fourth Rail Bridge. So I've got psychic teams out on up on the girders and down on the roadway, and it's all kind of going on. Though actually, in fairness to Peter, who's currently redecorating my sitting room, he does exactly the same thing. There's a bit of architrave there, and a bit, but it all ends at the same time. And when I'm in that state of mind, I'm looking at the environment around me, and I'm thinking, these are some of the things I thought while we were chatting. I thought, have I got enough carpet in this book? Because actually, I spend an awful lot of my time looking at carpet, and I'm also very preoccupied by environments like this where carpet is laid idiosyncratically. So you'll have a bit of carpet on a platform and a bit of carpet on the floor, which fundamentally alters your sense of it as a space. Is the carpet on the stage or on the low platform an attempt to domesticate the space? Or is it contrawise an attempt to institutionalise domestic space if we lay carpet in that way? And anyway, what about fitted carpets? My family didn't have fitted carpets until the early 70s. How far is our consciousness of fitted carpeting to do with the enclosure of the domestic environment and the presentation of the domestic environment as a single datum? I mean, coming back to marketing, which I feel we must, there is a sense in which the home has become a homologue, has become one thing. But does that relate to carpeting? Or does it relate to total surfacing? Does it relate to central heating, which is something I actually relate to the arrival of fitted carpeting as well? Both come in at the... You can see where I'm going with this.
You can see how rehearsed this all is. The reason I'm particularly drawn to this, everything is interesting as a
there's actually carpeting on the wall as well, I think. Yeah. I mean, what happens when you have total carpeting coverage? Is it cosy or is it insane? You know,
it's almost
a padded cell? I mean,
It's a large one.
And what about carpet underlay? What role does that play in it? Or, I mean, it's there the whole time, isn't it?
The reason I'm drawn to this is because... I'm going to get this question in. It's because it's very... This whole everythingitis that you talk about is kind of relevant to this audience in a way, because we often tend to skip around from discipline to discipline. You can be talking about shampoo to the future of the NHS to petrol. I'm going to get in massive trouble for saying this, but compared to research chemists who can spend a whole career on a couple of compounds, we're like the kind of the water boatman of the knowledge industry. So I'm quite interested in this thing of deep and narrow versus broad and shallow, and your kind of take on that.
Well, I mean, I feel among friends, because I think that's exactly how I would describe my own perspective. I think of myself as a water boatman on the meniscus of knowledge, and I don't find the idea of being very, very, very broadly shallow uncomfortable in that way. And in fact, I think our perspective tends, even though I'm sure everybody in the room has a particular interest or a particular focus, our capacity to move over the surface enables us to look down and assay depth the whole time. And I think that is important. I think that there are moments, and I'm sure, again, people in this room will have experienced them, probably everybody in this room, that, you know, are called classically epiphanies. Mm. And an epiphany is a moment when you are conscious of the relationship of whole and part in a very, very powerful way. And normally it's connected to some kind of insight. And the insight that it's usually connected to is instrumental. How do we get this done? Now I've perceived the entirety and I've perceived the particularity and the precise relationship between them, I can see a way forward to get this done, to do this. And really, I think that's what we're all in pursuit of, is those kinds of epiphanies. But we can only do it by constantly paying attention to the totality and to the detail. You know, the much worn adage that God is in the detail, I think is true. But God, since God is also omniscient and ever-present and imminent in all contexts, that what we mostly have to do is have that God consciousness. We are very religious this morning, aren't we? I'm getting increasingly religious. I think that's an age thing as well. And take care of the divine in the... What about this table? I mean, we're going to get on to psychology, but I was reminded because it's not actually a Dyson hand dryer in the gents here, but the Dyson Airblade system obviously they didn't have a lockdown patent on it, whatever they said. So it's proliferated now, and there's a kind of fancier version of the Airblade.
The 10-second countdown.
Right, but it's kind of aesthetically, it's got some sort of bright lights along the top rim, and it's matte. It's actually gloss black, And it's more, it's a bit like this. That's what upended, that's what made me think of it. But a year or two ago, I was chairing or part of the design awards, the design museum, and the Airblade had just come out, and there was another Dyson product up for the design awards. And I was sitting at this table with Stephen Bailey and a group of very high-powered designers, and we were talking about Dyson products. And I said, I peed into one of those Dyson Airblade hand dryers, and it was so powerful that not a drop of my urine fell onto the floor of the toilet. It completely... And they believed me. And I know we were going to get on to... I mean, that, as I'm sure a lot of you are aware, in classic psychological terms, is called the halo effect. But I realised that my halo was partly Uranus, but was very strange. I mean, what sealed their belief was that one of their number, and I can't remember her name, but she's very high up in the design industry, said, just as I'd finished saying that I had peed into the Dyson hand dryer, I said, that's disgusting. And it was her negative assertion that sealed the credibility of the statement. In other words, she confirmed my halo effect, which was, I am the kind of man that people suspect would pee into a Dyson Airblade hand dryer. And the surge of power I felt with these very eminent designers, at them all looking at me as this kind of deranged anarchist figure who would do anything, really. Mm. He sees an Airblade hand dryer, he urinates into it.
Do you suspect jealousy that they hadn't had the thought?
I hadn't considered that. I think that yeah, maybe, maybe. Do you think there's a latent Airblade hand dryer urinator in all of us that needs to be brought out?
Should we talk about it over coffee? what I'd like to do is to kind of take this idea, this kind of, you know, firing of thoughts and you know, the detail, the whole. How do you kind of corral all of that into the creative process? You know, how do you kind of decide that you've done enough research, for example, if you're looking into a new area? How do you just know when it's time to stop amassing stuff and just start writing?
Oh, well, I don't think you do. That's the problem. And I don't think you do. And I think this, again, hopefully people will find some torsion in their own work here, because my feeling is that, again, it's the relationship of contingency to data that is most interesting. So you can't have everything. You can't have all available data. You can't devise, even if you're looking at it quantitatively, there comes a point when you can't hope to, you have to produce a metric. And if you're working qualitatively, there comes a point where you have to make a deliberation.
Quite.
Yeah. Time is not inexhaustible, and it doesn't matter whether you can subject things to some kind of computer analysis or not. It's neither here nor there. And that does very much relate to the sort of work I do. If I want to set a scene in a given year, because I'm tending to write books that are set much more in the past at the moment, there is a point at which you have to stop gathering data on carpets in 1942. You really do. Otherwise, you know, you cannot say to yourself, well, a vital part of working on this book is that I visit the Axminster factory and talk to old Sid, who remembers the Sisal method of... But the temptation is there, the temptation of completeness, and the temptation that you can somehow might be able to know everything and therefore know how people respond. But here's the fact of the matter. By and large, While our behaviour may, to a greater or lesser extent, and this is a philosophical question, but it impacts upon the work that you all do, be determined, our perceptions are always contingent. We always think, well, I could have peed into that Dyson Airblade hand dryer. I mean, I didn't, but I mean, I was absolutely free to do so if I wished to. It's only social convention, my own anxiety about mopping up the pee, my lack of confidence in James Dyson, though he talks a good talk, that's prevented me. The awkwardness, if I happen to be a woman, of peeing into the Airblade hand dryer. It's all right for men, they can pee in Dyson Airblade hand dryers whenever they feel like it. It's just one of the terrible things about our culture. All of that is how we experience the world. And that level of understanding of contingency is what makes it possible to put an end to everythingitis.
Okay. And I suppose in the creative act, you've also got to make decisions about when is this information in the service of the story I'm trying to tell.
That's true. And you can say, but narrative, and I sort of suspect I know where you're going with this. Narrative is a very slippery thing, isn't it? I mean, narrative mimics determinism. It's like, and that's why it does so many emotional things for us. And this goes right back to Greek tragedy. Why would the Greeks have imagined that it's in some way cathartic to understand that Oedipus has no alternative but to fulfill the Sibyl's prophecy? It doesn't matter if he goes away for years and years. He could have stayed away another 5 years later. Where he could have gone to the loo instead of going back to Thebes, and there Laius would have been peeing into the Dyson hand dryer, and he would have killed him out of fury at this. You know, there is no... Why would the Greeks find that idea of tragic inevitability in some way cathartic? And the answer is because we all find the way in which narrative imposes a structured form of determinism on our contingent experience,
right,
satisfying, because it both explains it. But it also explains, and actually, I think, loosely speaking, our culture is very savvy to this, and we tend to subsume it under the uneasy heading postmodernism, though I'm not sure what that means. We're probably the first culture that absolutely understands that narrative takes away as much as it delivers. In other words, we're very, very careful about what we lend our suspension of disbelief to. And a lot of contemporary narrative forms are pre-programmed to undermine their own cathartic capability. They're highly ironized in that way, and they're often commenting on that role that they perform for us. So when we produce narratives about things, when we construct a narrative about anything, I think we're increasingly aware that it takes away as much as it gives.
And does that make it harder to be a storyteller now because of that kind of culture of reception that you know that you're writing into?
Well, I think it makes it harder for, you know, and I'm going to be quite shameless here. I think it makes it harder for a sophisticated audience. I think there is and people say, well, I have, you know, guilty cultural pleasures. And actually one of the guilty, or I love a jolly good read, or I couldn't sympathize with those characters, or I didn't suspend disbelief in it. People have a healthy appetite for simple narrative,
right,
still. And I think they always will. I think people, but I think that there is a, you know, in the city they call it the bunce. I think there is a bunce of sophistication in our culture that is always operating as well. And the kind of stuff I write is, you know, frankly, not full of sympathetic characters, and narrative is never presented in that kind of straightforward way.
I mean, in recent years, the world of business and brands and marketing has become obsessed with storytelling. And, you know, it's arguably come to the party relatively late, but now sees it as a kind of a mechanism for establishing some sort of greater connection to consumers, arguably with some mixed results. I mean, you must kind of have a view on that and observing the way in which businesses are trying to harness storytelling.
Yes, I do have a view on that. And I think that when it comes off badly, it's probably catastrophic, actually. I think it can be catastrophic for a brand to become, in a way, because of some of the things I've already said about narrative and about people's perception of narrative. In other words, if a consumer resiles from a brand or product narrative, I think it's game over, frankly. So you're on a very high wire act, because a narrative is not a simple datum. It's not a simple halo or aura. It actually involves the individual in being prepared to suspend disbelief over a period of time, over a series of linked events. And if you say, no, I'm not going to buy that, I'm not going to suspend disbelief in it, I don't believe in this in some sense, then the whole enterprise comes crashing down. Whereas a single statement around it, this is, so Louis Vuitton is luxury. Well, that's fine. You know, I can take the idea that Louis Vuitton is luxury one day and I can reject it the next, and I can retake it and reappropriate it the following day because it's associated with something that validates it. But if there's a whole story in my mind about how Louis was born in this, you know, and was beaten as a small child but loved handbags and and all he ever wanted to do. But I was at, I went out to Naples to do an interview on walking, which is one of my passions, for the Salvatore Ferragamo Museo in Florence. And, OK, maybe Salvatore Ferragamo has a great narrative, but, boy, is it overdetermined at the Salvatore Ferragamo Museum about how Salvatore, you know, lay on a pallet of straw dreaming about fantastically expensive women's shoes. And you sort of look at it and you think, no, you're absolutely off your chumps here. You know, it's going to... I mean, maybe it's particularly luxury goods that attract the proliferating biographical narrative in that way. But I also think, what's going on psychologically when we suspend disbelief in a narrative? And it is these key ideas of identification. It is the key willingness of the individual subject to abandon herself to the story. In other words, to allow that the creator of the narrative will present them with alternatives. And the interesting thing about this idea of narrative and a narrative relating to brands and marketing now, you say it's late to the feast. Boy, is it late to the feast, because in fact, narrative itself, the most powerful technology that's impacting on narrative at the moment is the video and computer game, which presents the individual subject with a different relationship to narrative itself. As a potential creator of alternative narratives. So I think people who are working in marketing need to consider whether or not traditional views of narrative as presenting the individual with a cheerful sense of determined events aren't too late altogether in some way. Not only is there a problem that if you don't buy any step of it, you reject the whole thing, but there's also the problem that individuals are now wanting very much to have the sense that they're constructing their own narrative about things.
And indeed, one of the traditional marketing tropes is the desire to control the message. And yet, with any kind of narrative or story, there's the clear sense of collaboration with the reader or the audience.
Right, but what does the reader or the audience bring to a narrative? You have to ask that. And the answer is, and this does relate very strongly, I think, to marketing, what the individual brings to narrative is, again, her subjectivity. So nobody's view of what characters in Jane Austen look like is the same, actually. And not only that, it's often quite, you know, one woman's Darcy is not another woman's Darcy, but the woman's Darcy may not even be, you know, if you said, well, who's your Darcy? And here I'm going to show you some photo fits of Darcy. You might not even actually have thought about what Darcy looked like. Maybe Darcy is the smell of Darcy's woolies, you know, or something that you associate very powerfully with a lover, which is often smell rather than visual. So, you know, you have to ask yourself that when you start trying to put together a narrative in a marketing context, what are people going to be bringing to that from their own subjective experience and their own, you know, and that's why I think on the whole branding narratives, which after all don't have the 80 or 90,000 words of a novel or the 2 hours of, now 3 hours if you're unlucky, of a feature film or the, you know, 67 hours of an HBO series to muck around with, what can they actually, what they tend to try and do is overdetermine what the subject's going to bring to the thing. So, and I think we've seen that with recent advertising campaigns that have kind of egregiously dealt with narrative, is that they tend always to go for sentiment, because they think if we can get enough sentiment in there, then we will drown out the possible contingency factor, which I think people are aware of, even if they're not articulating it.
One of the things that also strikes me about a brand story is a brand is a thing that's still going, and so the conclusion of its story is unknown. And I'm reminded of Mickey Spillane saying, nobody ever read a story to get to the middle. And so it's a kind of a complex thing to try and harness narrative when there's no conclusion yet to your
right,
story.
Where's the catharsis? I mean, if the narrative is the purchase and enjoyment of the product, then how does that relate to the perception of the product's or services' lifespan or relationship with you as an individual? That's right. I mean, in fact, Mickey Spillane would be right for brand narratives. The ideal brand narrative would be one that encouraged its consumer to get to the middle and stay there because then you would be in a continuous state of brand consciousness.
Yeah.
Now, and that actually exposes the tension in the whole idea, doesn't it?
Yeah. Okay. One of the areas that has been kind of exercising this world and this industry for some time has been the rise of behavioural economics and the whole sense in which we are unreliable witnesses to our own motivation and behaviour. And in fact, for those of you in the audience that don't know it, Will wrote one of his landmark early stories was called The Quantity Theory of Insanity, which has got a fantastical premise that there's a finite amount of sanity in any society, but not just in a society, but also in a subset, so such as in a conference room. So if anybody has a kind of... if anybody's in recovery from a psychiatric incident, by perforce, it means that somebody else in the same community drops their kind of their quotient of sanity. Anyway...
We've got a lot of people who are very sensitive to data here, so I don't know, there's maybe 300 or 400 people in the room, so statistically, you know, at least 40 people here will be on some form of anxiolytic medication, some kind of anxiety medication right now. So if you don't have your dose today, just don't. Then you will notice by this afternoon, as you become more agitated and unhappy, that other people will get really chilled. You have that kind of marginal... That's what the quantity theory of insanity would predict, because there's only a fixed amount of mental well-being to go around in any societal or sub-societal group. And it's the only question is, it's a bit like when women live together and their period synchronizes. It's the only thing the theory doesn't really effectively predict is how quickly a sub-societal group is formed. So if it was a successful... I would hazard, as the person who originated the theory, that if it was a successful conference, then it would probably develop its own unique sanity quotient much quicker. So, you know, perhaps we could experiment.
Later. In the story, there's a formula that's sort of brought into play very early in the story, which is that events are reconstructed more often than they're constructed. And this is a theme that you've come back to a lot about the fallibility of memory and mental illness and all of that associated hinterland of that. And it's become very prescient because in recent years we've seen an awful lot of work from people like Kahneman talking about the division between the experiencing self and the remembering self. So you've been, you've been swimming in waters that are now very much in the forefront.
Well, I think we need to beware of fashion, and particularly intellectual fashions. And I think that intellectual fashions set themselves up against fashion. You know, so what every intellectual trend presents you with is a level of insight that you can't possibly get by buying a new pair of shoes. That's its promise to you. But every intellectual, and I'm not altogether dissing the idea of behavioural economics, nor am I dissing the idea that neuroscience may have important things to tell us about individual behaviour. But as you get older, you have seen these things come and go, rather. And you've tended to see more basic heuristics, more basic ways of interpreting data that remain quite consistently. You know, I don't think there's any... And this is a philosophic point, maybe it's a bit heavy for a morning after which people haven't had enough time at the oxygen bar. But since philosophers haven't solved the problem of free will and determinism up until now, there's no reason to believe that Eric Kahneman has either. You know, I mean, I think we'd know about it by now if he had. Therefore, our fundamental problem and your fundamental problem in assessing the extent to which people are either determined or making genuine choices based on a rational calculus in any given situation probably remains the same as it was in Athens, in Periclean Athens. You know, so therefore we have to ask ourselves, well, what does behavioural economics bring to the table ideologically? What's it trying to tell us?
So, but do you have any personal kind of scepticism about the idea that we're to some degree influenced by cognitive biases that we can't access ourselves?
Yes, I think we are influenced by a vast hinterland of instinctive drives, socioculturally constructed, though not so intensively hardwired predispositions. There's absolutely no doubt about that in my mind at all. But while an industry, I mean, it sort of relates to the quotes that Jane put up on the board. Why we can research that, we can determine that, we can create all sorts of scientific ways of looking at people's behaviour. Mm. What are we going to say to them in the end? What are we going to say to them, either as responsible professionals who are analysing this behaviour, or what are we going to say to people who want to sell to them on the basis of that information? Because, you know, when I was a kid, and I'm probably the older people remember this, I mean, it was a bit of an urban myth about subliminal marketing. And I always remember the one when Lawrence of Arabia came out, which must have been in the late 60s, I can't remember when. The idea was that they flashed a millisecond image of a can of Pepsi or Coke up on the screen during the particularly deserty scenes. So that in those days, it was a long film, there was an intermission. And during the intermission, everybody was going to charge down to the foyer and tank up on Coke because of this subliminal message. So you have to say to yourself, okay, with everything we can extract from behavioural economics, what's our aim? Mm. Is it aim actually to market to people against their will? Is that what we really want to do? No, because if that's what we want to do, then it has major implications for society, and we should follow the consequences of them into full-blown fascist regimes and not bother.
And in fact,
pass go.
And in fact, what I have heard you say is that there is a role for marketing to help us as the public to become more effective consumers. What do you mean by that?
Well. Again, this is all very ideologically loaded as well. I mean, we've seen... I'm always very interested, because I'm a person who works with words, about what words are most in currency, because they tell you a lot about what people are thinking or what people think they're thinking. So just to give you a brief rundown, and I'm obsessed by this. So, for example, at the moment, the most important... I mean, we... philologists call it a nonce phrase. In other words, it has no ostensible meaning, is to be honest. Now, you must have noticed the power of this meme at the moment. It has become, and people are absolutely, they're more incontinent with their to be honest than I notionally am with my urine when I see a Dyson airblade. Far more. It's almost always deployed in sentences that are not capable of being doubted, okay? In other words, in which you would never suspect that somebody would lie. Have you noticed that? So it's, I like to go to Spain for my holidays, to be honest. Right. What is the alternative world in which you actually lie about where you like to go on holiday? why has to be now a few years ago, though not with such devastating, I mean, of course, to be honest, has a fairly, you know, respectable pedigree. Go back to the 60s and 70s, and people just tacked honestly on the end of things. Oh, I love the Queen, honestly. Right. Okay. What's it like to love the Queen dishonestly? And to be engaged in that deep a traitorous relationship with a constitutional monarchy? I mean, that's a bit strange. A few years ago, not as powerful as, to be honest, was at the end of the day, which sort of crept out from football management and, you know, at an interesting time in the relationship of football to the wider culture, actually at the time in which football teams were becoming brands. Mm. So there's something going on there. And at the end of the day, was a millennial expression. It was, in my view, an articulation of an anxiety about YK2 and about the end of civilization. It really, no, I believe this sort of thing. To be honest, I relate to choice. Another big word at the moment. And another very interesting thing in terms of the way in which we've, what's happening to marketing. Mm. Now, in a world in which a linguistic conversational tick is in fact a self-questioning about the status of things that are unquestionable, it reflects to me a world in which individual subjects perceive choices as being chimerical. Okay, in other words, they don't really believe that the choices they're being presented with are real choices. Mm. Now, you may find that all rather far-fetched, but I think, you know, early tomorrow morning you're going to wake up and go, he was right. I'm planting it as a slow detonation seed in you. So what's our responsibility? Is our responsibility to provide people with choice, even if that choice is not real, or is our responsibility to provide people with information to make informed choices over choices that are valid? Mm. And I think that's affecting a lot of thinking around the relationship between the private and the public sector in our culture, and the relationship between, it penetrates in every area, the relationship between assets and disposable income, how we think about that, and so on.
Right. I want to ask you one more question before throwing it open to the floor to close. And that is, I would like to kind of get your perspective on cities, which you write a lot about with tremendous passion. What's your kind of diagnosis of the current state of our cities, and of course this one in particular?
Well, London, as the philosopher John Gray, I think, rightly identified a few year or two ago, is going to become the Singapore of Britain. And the rest of Britain is going to become a kind of Southeast Asian hinterland.
As simple as that?
Pretty much, yeah. But I mean, it's fairly inevitable the way things are going. And you can see what's happening at the moment. And it simply relates to property values. And, you know, I don't want to be, I'm not, in fact, partisan about this. I'm not making a moral statement, but let's just look at the reality of it. Last year, again, for the first year since the 2007-08 hiccup, an average London property owner will have notionally banked more off the increase in the value of their property than they did from their pay packet. Mm. So that tells you that the kind of freeze-drying effect of property values is back in action. And the only thing that can possibly interrupt it, because it is being fueled by foreign capital inflows, is some major systemic collapse, again, of the banking system, or the political will to change it. And there is no evidence, well, the former is still a distinct likelihood, but there's no evidence of a political will to affect it. Okay. So I think that's the most obvious thing that's going to happen in. And for those of you who've come from some of the other major provincial cities in Britain, I spend a lot of time at the moment in Manchester. And Manchester tried quite hard to Londonize in the 90s and into the 2000s. And I don't mind being lynched by people from Manchester after the session if I say I don't think it's worked. I mean, it's palpably not worked. The urban experience in Manchester is not what has happened in London. I also think that one of the problems for the provincial cities is that London, even when Felix Mendelssohn, the composer, came here in for the first time in the early 1820s, he wrote in a letter home to his family, "It is magnificent and terrible and uncontrollable." And London has a dynamic about it as a city that that is very, very interesting and is summed up in its civil government and in you know. For example, the mayor, who I'm personally very fond of, is a self-confessed and self-enacting buffoon, right? He's mostly responsible for traffic management. That's what his remit is. He follow the money. He doesn't have local tax-raising powers. The property taxes in this city are a fraction of what they are in New York or in Paris. So he's essentially a kind of mop-topped busman. Who commands a national political stage. And as I say, I know Boris, I'm fond of him personally, but that's what he is, okay? Yeah. And we love it. I mean, and why do we love it? We love it because I think, and this is not true of other, the tension between a sense of organisation and progress in London and a love of its contingency and anarchy is present in the heart and soul of every Londoner, and that's irrespective of where they stand on the political spectrum or where they stand even in terms of social spectrum. And that's a very unusual phenomenon in the city. It's why I can't leave. You know.
We've just got time for a couple of questions. Probably not nearly as many as people want to ask, but we have the roving mics. Who would... Over here. Do you want to come, gentlemen, in front?
Hi. You talked about choice, and I think that's key to us as researchers and marketers, and whether it's real or imagined choice. But what about, why do you think the concept of choice has become so popular now when I suspect it sort of wasn't anywhere near as popular in the 70s or the 60s?
I think that in the post-war period, people had a concept, the idea of relative poverty hadn't come into being yet. People had a strong sense of the idea that the Western developed economies and cultures in the post-war period still had levels of absolute desirable wealth and social security to aim for, and that there was physical and cultural and social capital to be gained, that had no penumbra of doubt about it. National Health Service, people had been on rationing for years. You know, the people's sense of privation was keen. Now everything's become very, very muddy, and very, very confused. And the notion of relative poverty, which I believe actually is a shibboleth that is mouthed to disguise other anxieties about how our culture and our society operates, confuses people. It acts to confuse people about whether what they desire is desirable in and of itself in an absolute sense, or is only desirable within a local context of goods, a kind of portfolio of goods in that way. And I think that discourse also relates to the intersection between people's view of themselves as belonging to a collectivity that is advancing in some way, and people's view of themselves as atomized within a wider culture in which... And it is, you know, again, I don't want to be... I'm not partisan or party political. I don't think that it is a contentious thing to say that it relates to the wholesale shift in our culture from one in which we viewed our involvement in wider society as being part of a general and collective advancement, to one in which we are encouraged to view ourselves as individuals out for whatever we can get or take. I don't think that is a tendentious view. It's just the case. You know.
Hi, I really enjoyed the talk. I want to bring the tone down slightly, if that's all right. I'd like your opinion on a quote by the late great Bill Hicks, if you will. He says, "By the way, if anyone here is in marketing or advertising, kill yourself. Thank you. Just planting seeds is all I'm doing. No joke here, really. Seriously, kill yourself. You have no rationalization for what you do. You are Satan's little helpers. Kill yourself, kill yourself, kill yourself now. Rid the world of your evil fucking presence." I imagine most people in this room don't agree with that. I'm just wondering whether he has a point.
I think he goes on to say in the same routine, in respect of any artist of any kind who ever endorses a product, "You've made your choice. I don't care if you shit Mona Lisa's on cue. You're no longer an artist." yes. well, I think to be emollient, I think Martin and I were talking about this beforehand. I do regard myself as an artist. And I never have done advertising, and I've never given any kind of commercial endorsement whatsoever on the Hicks basis. However, as my wife is very keen to point out, you don't mind advertising or marketing your own products. And the truth of the matter is, and perhaps that gives us a way to square on the face of it what is a very, very strong and polarized view from the late Mr. Hicks. Maybe our responsibility, if we're working in this industry, is to really, maybe our ethical responsibility is to put ourselves in the position of the consumer, not on the basis of economic behaviorism, not on the basis of rational choice theory, not on the basis of this, that, or the other paradigm, but existentially and humanly and sympathetically. And maybe the late Mr. Hicks, if Bill's ghost is up there, and actually, to bring things full circle, he was a believer. So maybe if Bill's up there, he will smile a little more kindly on what we do. If, as Martin suggested before, and as the quotes that Jane put up suggested, there is a role, particularly for the kind of work that market researchers do, in genuinely informing consumers in a responsible way, and as acting as that responsible, point of communication between what, let's face it, can often be pretty diabolic motivations on the part of people who simply want to sell things. So maybe we can get around that a little bit, just a little bit.
I'm afraid I'm going to.
But you are looking quite horny. It's true.
And I'm afraid I'm going to have to call it there. But I would just like to... James Joyce famously said, every talk has his stay. And unfortunately, we've had our stay, Will. But I'm sure you'd want to join with me in thanking Will for a truly riveting talk.